Blender 2.81 makes denoising your renders dead simple. But there are a couple do's and don'ts that I want to go over here that are going to be really important. I'm Jonathan Lampel from cgcookie.com, and today I'll take you through all of the questions you may or may not have had about this new feature. 2.81 is not out yet, I'm using the alpha version, so if it's not out by the time you watch this, you can just go to blender.org/experimental. Here I just have a very noisy image that I rendered out with 50 samples. And it's pretty complex. It's got some transparent materials, some caustics, a lot going on. So let's just press Shift A, go to Filter, and Denoise. You just need to throw it on there and wait a second, and you're good to go. It's basically magic. Obviously, this still looks a little bit splotchy, and so to get a better result, you'd still want to increase your sample count. But now instead of having to render out 5,000 samples, maybe you'd only have to render out 700, and that time saving is huge. The way to get an even better result with the same amount of samples is by plugging in more information into the Denoise node. First of all, the HDR just allows this to process the image with the high dynamic range. And so you can see if we turn this off, what it's going to do is kind of crush the bright areas a little bit, and it's not going to look as accurate. So I'd recommend leaving that on basically all the time. For the normal, we're going to need a normal output from this render layer. So let's go to our view layers in our properties editor that I've just stuck to the left side over here. So we have a normal check here under passes and data, and to get the albedo, we could look at under light, diffuse, and color. However, there's also another checkbox called denoising data, and if we turn that on, you can see that we get a lot more information, including denoising normal and denoising albedo. So let's try both of these and see how they differ. First, I'm going to take this denoise node, hit Shift D, and duplicate this down. This one, I'm going to use the image, just as usual. I'll plug the normal into the normal and the diffuse color into the albedo. Let's take a look at what the normal looks like. You can see it's completely smooth, so there's no noise here, and it's just giving us the direction that these faces are pointing, which is going to be really helpful for crisping up the edges. If we look at the diffuse color, you can see that it gives us the just raw color of the diffuse materials, and everything else, the glossy shaders, the emission shaders, basically everything that's not a diffuse is just rendered as black. However, what is the diffuse color? Because there's no light bouncing around here, it's just the direct light, there's no noise whatsoever, it's completely smooth. And so that helps give us the texture information. So if we look at the denoise node now, you can see that this already looks a lot better. If we flip between the two, you may start to notice some differences, but maybe not in the video until we really zoom in. So first, let's look at this right-hand corner where we have the wood on the table and also the cover of this sketchbook. If we flip between the two, the first thing you'll notice is that the texture looks much better in the second one thanks to that diffuse color information. Before, it was kind of blurred out, but now it looks great. Another thing that's really helpful here is the normal. So if we look at the denoise without the normal, you can see that it's blurred some areas, including the etching on this computer and part of the lamp on the side. But as soon as we plug in that normal and we tell the denoising algorithm which way the faces are pointing and where their edges are, we get a way better result. So this already looks quite good. And for rendering it out at only 50 samples of a really noisy image, this is very impressive. But we can actually get even better by using the denoising information. So let's hit Shift D, and I'm going to do this one more time, but this time using the denoising normal and the denoising albedo. Let's plug in the image here, and let's look at the difference between the regular normal and the denoising normal. Here, you can see that everything looks completely solid, but if we go down to the denoising normal, then the transparent materials are actually transparent, and it's even taking the refraction into account on this glass. So you can even see the normal of the pencils and pens inside of this cup, which is really, really cool. You can also look at the reflective surfaces and notice that there's a lot more information here. But because it actually needs to use those traced paths to calculate the refraction and such, it's going to be a little bit more noisy. Similarly, with the denoising albedo, not only does it include just the diffuse pass, but it also includes the color for all of the other passes as well, including the glossy passes, the emission passes, all of that stuff. But again, because it has to use transparency and even refraction, it's going to be a little bit noisy. And you can see here that we have some artifacts around this glass. So that's a little bit less than ideal, but let's look at the difference between the two. Here's the first denoise that is using the regular normal, and it's kind of blurring and smearing what's inside of this glass here. If we look at it on the second version, everything is now much more sharp, but we do get some artifacts on the glass, and those would go away if we used more samples. So depending on what your needs are, you might want to use one over the other. What's also cool about the denoising normal is it's finding the normal inside of the reflection. So if we zoom in on this bottom of the lamp here, you can see that it's reflecting part of the arm. If we look at the first one, that reflection is being blurred out. But because we're actually getting the reflected normal in here, then it's going to look much more accurate. Again, that could end up being a little bit more noisy, but in complex scenes, it's going to look a lot more crisp. So it all depends on what you want more. Do you want more accuracy or do you want more smoothness? It's up to you. Now, those are all the settings that this denoise node has, and for just that, it works extremely well. I'm going to compare this with the other denoiser and also the nVidia denoiser, but first I'd like to take a look at a couple other examples. The first thing I wondered when I was using this is, does it work with photos? Because it works really well for rendered images. So what I have here is a very noisy photo. I'll just drag and drop that in. And if we look at it, you can see that it's a picture that I took that turned out to be a kind of a cool image, but it was way too dark and I didn't have my settings right. And so it just came out very noisy and it's not really something I could use. So let's zoom in on some of this noise here and let's try plugging in this denoise filter. It's going to take a second because the image is pretty big. Once it's done doing its thing, you probably won't notice any difference, and that's because it hasn't removed any of the noise whatsoever. The reason that this denoise node does not work on images is because it's been trained using a neural network to target specifically ray traced pattern noise. Ray tracing produces a pretty predictable result of noise, and so it's able to focus in on that very specifically, which is why it can usually get really good results with even fairly low sample counts. But when the noise is a different type of pattern, for example, a pattern that would come out of a camera, it simply just doesn't work at all. So unfortunately, this only is going to work with rendered images. That brings into question though, what about other renders? And in this case, I'm thinking about Eevee. Well, I have a scene set up here that has an image that's been rendered out from Eevee. If we rotate around the scene itself, you can see that although we don't really think of Eevee as being noisy, in some situations it can be. First, for reflections, if we don't have the sample count turned up high enough, or for hashed shadows or hashed transparency. You can see that this is actually quite noisy. Now, this could be fixed if we turned up the sample count really, really high, but even at a sample count of 32, which is double the viewport, it's still very noisy. We'd have to turn it up extremely high to get a completely smooth result, so why not try denoising it? Let's hit Shift A, Filter, and Denoise, and plug that right in. Once that does its thing, you can see that it actually looks very successfully denoised. But that's only for the hashed transparency. The hashed shadow that's below it actually is still kind of jagged because it's a different pattern since it's been stretched out across the top of the cube. So it's not going to work for that, but it has worked for this transparent area for the monkey. But for the reflections, it actually doesn't work because again, that's a different type of pattern. So the answer of whether it works with Eevee or not is kind of, in only some certain situations. Now you might think we could get a better result by plugging in the normal, but if we do that, you can see that it actually returns about back to normal. There are some areas that are smoothed out a little bit, but overall it looks about as if we had not denoised it at all. And that's because if we look at the normal pass, it's calculating it based on that hashed transparency, so even the normal itself is very noisy. So it's not really any help. And we also don't have an albedo pass to work with in Eevee, so we're also going to get very blurred textures. Another thing that you might be wondering is, since this node was implemented by Intel, would it only work on Intel systems? And here I can tell you that no, it actually works on anything that can run Blender. I don't have Intel anything in my computer, so I have an AMD Threadripper processor, and everything else is not Intel. So while they were the people who implemented it, they made sure that it works for everybody. And that's a little bit different than the NVIDIA denoising that we're going to look at in a bit. Now let's check out denoising animations. When I play this really slowly, you can see that each individual frame by itself looks great. But when I speed this up, you can definitely tell that there's a lot of jittering going on, especially in those complex areas like the glass and the table. That's because the node only has one single frame to work with. Because it can't see the noise patterns in the frames before it or after it, it has no way of blending between them. Increasing the sample count definitely helps a lot, but even at 500 samples, there's still some jitter going on. Throw 1,000 samples at it and it's almost gone, but not quite. Even so, it's still way better than not denoising it at all. So it works, you're just going to need a lot more samples than you would with a still image. One thing I tried was turning on the Animate Samples property under the Sampling settings, and that definitely made it worse, so leave that off. I also tried changing the sampling pattern from Sobol to correlated multi-jitter, and that, interestingly enough, had no effect at all. I wouldn't go too crazy testing all this yet though, as much better animation denoising is on the to-do list of Attila Afra, the Intel dev who implemented the node in the first place. He even used an exclamation mark on Twitter, so you know he means business. I tried to stump it by introducing some motion blur, but that actually works great too, thanks to the fact that it blurs the albedo in normal passes. Depth of field? No problem. What about removing fireflies while keeping small and bright specular highlights? Not sure how that works, but it looks good. It's a lifesaver for indoor scenes with a lot of bounce lighting, and it even works with hair. I'm honestly having a hard time finding an example of where it doesn't work well. Just because something uses machine learning doesn't always mean that it's better, but in this case, it absolutely crushes the old denoiser. Not only does it look better in every situation, it's also significantly faster. NVIDIA also has a machine learning-based denoiser, and you can use it via the Denoise add-on from Remington Graphics. Intel's implementation into Blender, though, beats that too, both in terms of quality and speed. You can see this most clearly at low sample counts, where Intel's just does a better job at upholding the textures and normals. It also takes into account the fact that more samples introduces more light, while NVIDIA's remains incorrectly dark. Plus, it works on every computer, not just NVIDIA's graphics cards. I don't want to give NVIDIA too much of a hard time though, because they are working with Blender to implement OptiX into Cycles itself, which is a lot more than just denoising. It's actually a whole back-end ray tracing architecture, which, when implemented in Cycles, will give the ability for anybody with an RTX card to use those special cores to really speed things up. It may also pave the way for real-time viewport denoising, which I am super excited for. I have a little section about NVIDIA RTX and real-time ray tracing in my blog post about Cycles and Eevee, so if you're curious about that, you can check the link below. I'd also recommend checking out Andrew Price's recent video on denoising, because it shows Neat Video in action, which is a plugin for After Effects or Premiere Pro that does a really good job of denoising video, and I use that all the time for both animation and film. If you've already given denoising a shot, let me know what you think in the comments. If you learned something helpful or just found this video interesting, click like and subscribe. That way, I can see you in the next one.